TVs were the very first product tested here at Ratings. The review started way back in 2011 by our president, Cedric Demers. Thanks to your support and feedback, we've been constantly updating our methods and reviews ever since. What you may not know is that we review products according to our test benches, which are iterations of testing methodologies. We have just implemented our newest TV test bench update, version 1.6. This aims at not only improving our internal methodology, but also to help guide you in finding the best product for your needs. As of today, we have tested over 300 TVs, and we are looking forward to testing this year's newest models for you. Keep in mind that all models we test are bought by us, and so as long as we have them, we can revisit them through future test bench updates. Hi, I'm Adam, a tester here at ratings.com. Today, I'll be discussing our TV test bench update 1.6. We'll look at the changes and improvements it brings over the previous methodology and what it means for our TV reviews moving forward. While you're here, make sure you subscribe to our channel for the latest videos or check out our website for the full changelog. TV Test Bench 1.6 released in early March, and so far we retested 55 TVs with this newer methodology. Test Bench 1.6 brings many changes, ranging from minor adjustments to much larger additions. We'll first start by discussing some of these smaller changes and then move into the bigger stuff, like the additions for advanced console compatibility for the new PS5 and Xbox Series X, and HDR brightness changes. If you want to skip straight to a section, then check out the timestamp below, or use YouTube Chapters feature. To start off, you'll see that we have removed the score for style. We found that not only do the majority of TVs look great today, but also this score was a bit too subjective. Our goal is to always keep our community in mind, and we felt this change was necessary. You'll be able to still see the style from the photos, and we find this is better than providing a score for it. We made some quality of life changes in the SDR brightness segment of the review. We renamed SDR peak brightness to simply be SDR brightness. We also removed SDR from the brightness subtest names. We decided to cut the SDR ABL abbreviation and simply go with its full name, Automatic Brightness Limiting. For those who don't know, the Automatic Brightness Limiter test measures the perceived change in brightness depending on the average picture level of the content being watched. It matters for content with large bright areas, such as for PC or video game use, and sports such as hockey, where you'd like to have brightness remain constant. The same quality of life changes were made to the HDR brightness as well. One thing to note here, though, is that we moved the HDR EOTF plot from the color gamut box to the HDR brightness box. We improved the axis labels of the HDR EOTF plot as well, to make it easier and clearer to read. EOTF stands for Electro-Optical Transfer Function. The graph basically provides a metric of how much the brightness noticeably changes when displaying different content in HDR. Now, let's move on to some of the meatier changes. We decided to add a local dimming in game mode box. We want to showcase what to expect with local dimming in game mode, as we know it was something brought up by you guys. The intent here is to capture the performance of the TV while in game mode. The methodology is the same as our general local dimming tests, but instead we use our recommended gaming settings versus the normal settings. The reason why we decided to add this is because we know you all had concerns with some of the TV's performance in game mode. Samsung TVs, for example, seem to struggle when in game mode while having local dimming on. For example, take a look at the Samsung Q80T and Q800T. The brightness of the Q80T when local dimming is active while in game mode doesn't actually do much. There aren't too many noticeable flaws, but it also doesn't add any improvements to dark scenes. The local dimming in this case barely reacts to subtitles, and the local dimming feature overall is inconsistent when in game mode. If you'd like to see our results for the Samsung Q80T as an example, you can check out our review by clicking the link over here. Other big brand TV manufacturers' brightness don't seem to vary that much when local dimming is active in game mode. Let's take a look at the Sony X900H or even the Hisense H9G. The Sony X900H looks and works the same in and out of game mode, allowing for a more consistent visual experience. This is also true for the H9G from Hisense. If you want to see either one of these reviews, you can click the links over here. You'll notice that we've cleaned up our usage scores as well to better showcase our scoring components. Now, we're currently working on another test for local dimming with real content. At the time of filming this video, this test isn't quite ready, and I'll explain why in a second. But first, we need to talk about our goals when developing tests. Our goal is for our testing to be as useful as possible for you. There are a few ways we try to focus on that. One is that we prioritize the tests that we add or change by the impact it has on you. We base this on the feedback we receive in comments from videos like this, or on our website, across a range of forums like Reddit and others. One important thing to note is that everyone has different preferences. Talking specifically about local dimming, this is a feature that can dim or brighten certain areas or zones of the screen. It helps with increasing the picture quality with deeper blacks and brighter highlights. Now, the problem is that no TV is perfect, and some scenes are more challenging than others. In these scenes, the local dimming algorithm needs to make decisions about the right trade-offs to make. For example, subtitles in dark scenes can be particularly challenging. If the local dimming zones are relatively large, then both a dark background and a bright subtitle can be in the same zone. Does the zone brighten to increase the visibility of the subtitle, or darken to increase the immersion of the dark scene? There's no absolute right answer to this. Some people might prefer one way or the other. That's just one example, but these trade-offs are occurring all the time for a wide range of parameters. For example, local dimming zones that react quickly to the appearance of a bright object may be jarring as the image visibly brightens, while a slow reaction can result in the scene not displayed as it was intended, or a loss of some bright detail. So, how do we handle situations like this? Well, where possible, we prefer to show you the performance of the product and allow you to make the decision yourself. If we do a good job, you should already know exactly how the product performs in relation to your own usage and preferences before you click that buy button. In the case of local dimming, this is tricky, but we're giving it a shot. We tried a bunch of different cameras to find the one that best captures both bright and dark details. We've captured and experimented with a range of test content to best show real-world examples with dark scenes, movement of highlights, and subtitles. We also experimented with different processing, encoding, and bit rates to preserve the result and make sure that the way you view and assess the footage on your TV is as close as possible to the way we experienced it on the product we're testing. Now, as I mentioned before, at the time of filming, this isn't yet published and is still a work in progress. Look out for it on our 2021 TV reviews. Looking now at another addition to our review is the HDR brightness in game mode. We added this due to the feedback we got from you guys, our community. We all know that when in game mode, the TV isn't processing at its fullest potential. In our testing, Samsung TV's brightness tend to degrade the most. The local dimming behavior and brightness changes is what we're trying to showcase for you with this addition. We really aren't trying to pick on Samsung here, but we do hope that they can address these shortcomings in the future. Like I had mentioned with the regular content HDR changes, we have also updated the access labels of the HDR EOTF in game mode plot. This should help clarify any misinterpretations of the graph. Again, we moved the plot from the color gamut section of the review to now being in the HDR brightness in game mode box. HDR peak brightness has also been replaced with HDR brightness in game mode in the HDR gaming usage. We've saved the best for last. We heard you guys loud and clear, so we've decided to add advanced console compatibility to our TV reviews. Trust me when I say we feel the struggle when it comes to trying to lock down one of these new consoles. Ryan's been our eyes and ears scanning multiple Discord groups and vendors to get a hold of one of these gems. You'll find this new review box in the input section, and we can now test the TV's compatibility with the new PS5 and the Xbox Series X's advanced features. What we do is we first connect the PC to the proper HDMI port and set the TV to game mode. We make sure that each TV is set to its optimal gaming settings in HDR. We ensure that full bandwidth is turned on, and depending on the TV manufacturer, we follow the optimal settings outlined in our methodology. For the Xbox Series X, what we do is ensure ALLM is turned on and that all checkboxes in the Xbox menu are selected. We take note of all the settings that are able to be activated and also those that cannot be activated while using the TV. What we're basically looking for here is if a 4K TV can actually utilize the Xbox's compatibilities of gaming in 4K 120 frames per second. We do the same thing for 1440p and 1080p. We also check to see if the VRR feature on the TV is working as expected by verifying if the frame rate is varying while VRR is enabled. The PS5 has been giving us some trouble. ours seems to crash after launching a game and playing it for a couple of minutes. We're planning on replacing our PS5, but as you know, it's a nightmare trying to get a hold of one of these guys right now. For the time being, our PS5 is doing what it needs to in order for us to showcase our results to you all. We double-checked to make sure that once the Xbox is disconnected, that none of our TV game mode settings have been altered from when the TV was initially set up for the advanced console compatibility test. We checked the screen and video settings on the PlayStation and note what is able to be activated and what is not supported by the TV being tested. We then launch our 120Hz test game, which we chose to be COD Cold War. We check the TV signal info to make sure it is in fact displaying 4K at 120Hz with HDR activated. We do the same thing for 4K 60 and 1080p 120, and we check how things are working in the SDR format as well. As of today, VRR is not supported on the PS5, nor is 1440p. We found and verified that ALLM on both consoles work the same, so we don't retest ALLM with the PS5. We simply test it with the Xbox. All right, so what do you think of the new test bench? Is there anything you'd like to see further improved? We're always looking for feedback from people like you on how we can improve our reviews. Let us know any suggestions you have in the comments below or in the Changelog page of our website. Speaking of test benches, we just started testing cameras and our test bench 0.7 is rather simplistic. So if you have any suggestions on what to improve, let us know below. Also, we're currently hiring in our offices in Montreal for various positions. So if you want to help people find the best product for their needs, have a look at our careers page. You can check out all our TV reviews on our website. If you like this video, subscribe to our channel and become an insider on the website for access to our latest results first. So that's it. Thanks for watching and see you next time.